The video lecture today is going to be focused on study of cosmology, and what I'm going to do in this video is it's going to be short because I'm just going to give an introduction to the ideas of cosmology and then redirect you to a BBC documentary that talks about a lot of the discoveries that form the current cosmology we have today. At the end of the video, just to be clear, cosmology. Formally means the study of the formation and evolution of large-scale structure in the universe. That's formally what we mean when we say cosmology. We're trying to understand the nature of the entire universe and how it's changed over time. And today, the cosmological theory that is adhered to is called the Big Bang Theory. This hasn't always been the case. If you go back a good 100 years ago, the idea of a finite universe was a non-existent idea. For whatever reason, it has always been assumed, believed, that our universe was infinite in all respects, space, time, matter, and so on. But there has been various questions throughout history that has questioned those ideas. And one of these ideas is called Olber's paradox. And Olber's paradox is basically a question. And the question is, why is the sky dark at night? With the assumption that the universe is infinite in all respects, we shouldn't have a dark sky. And the idea is that if the universe is infinite, then when you look out into space, if you look far enough away, you would eventually see the surface of a star. And no matter what direction you look, you always would terminate on the surface of a star. Now, of course, there's the brightness law that says that sources of light get fainter, but as you get further away from something, you have an increase in the amount of matter there. And so if matter is approximately uniformly distributed, the amount of light that we would get would go up by basically a cube factor. The amount of matter, and the brightness law is a squared factor in drop-in. So we actually, as you get further and further away, you expect to see more and more matter, and things should be very bright. And in fact, if you basically average the surface temperature of stars, then you're basically saying that the sky shouldn't be dark. It actually should be bright. You have a universe that has an infinite amount of stars and have been around for an infinite amount of time. That means they've been shining for an infinite amount of time. And so we really shouldn't see dark patches in the sky, and that's odd that we do. And there's been various sort of thought experiments as to how to come up with a solution to this paradox, and the one that makes the most sense is that the reason why there's dark patches in the sky is because either there's just nothing there, or the light hasn't reached us yet. And those statements come from the perspective of a finite universe. If the universe is finite, then there would be a finite amount of matter. It would be around for a finite amount of time, and there would be a finite distance. And therefore, there would be observable and unobservable regions of the universe. Regions that are unobservable are just ones that are so far away that the light hasn't reached us yet, just hasn't had enough time. And so these ideas have started to become more and more popular, over the course of several decades, starting from around the 20s to the 1960s, there was a big change in cosmological thinking from what we call a steady state universe, one that believed that, you know, the universe is infinite, to what we have today, which is a Big Bang. And this is the result of a lot of observations that have cosmological significance to them. And so the video you're going to see covers two of those important cosmological observations. We see things like galaxies expanding away from each other. We see a heat signature in the universe that indicates the universe was hotter in the past. We see an evolution of objects in time. Quasars were a thing of the past, they don't exist today. Star formation was much more vigorous in the past, it's not as much today. You look at the chemical composition of elements in the universe. There was fewer elements in the past and more elements today, indicating that stars are creating elements and recycling them back into the still medium. And there's actually just tons and tons of these observations that all have a cosmological significance to them. There are the observations, and there are the interpretations of those observations. And all of the observations have an implication of a finiteness, a beginning to the universe. And to explain that, we have the Big Bang Theory, which is simply the idea that the universe was smaller in the past and hotter, and at some point, if you go far enough back in time, the universe would have existed in a point that later sort of exploded, basically expanded out and formed the structure that we have today. Now, before I actually show you the video, there are going to be some assumptions that we have to make about what we're going to do here. So these are kind of like ground rules for what we're going to discuss here, because we have some limitations when we want to talk about the entire universe. And we don't like to make assumptions, but in fact, we never want to make assumptions, but sometimes we're forced to make assumptions. And let me give you an example of doing this. Say, for example, you are trapped in your house, but you wanted to come up with a theory on how plants work. But you couldn't really get outside, move around, and see all the different plants and trees that exist around the earth. Maybe you had some in your house, you could look at those, and you could see some things that are directly outside your house, but there's a lot of the house you can't, there's a lot of the world you can't see. So if you're going to make a theory about how, you know, plants work, you have a limited amount of information, and some of the limitations are either physical limitations or they're just impossible to execute because of the amount of time or something like that. So it's the same deal here. We're stuck on Earth. We've been outside the Earth a little bit. We've been around our solar system. We haven't been outside of our solar system. So we have to make some assumptions about the nature of the universe. Now, these could be wrong, and cosmologists would, in some ways, like this to be wrong, because it would hopefully point them in another direction that would lead them to a better answer of how the universe is. But this is all falls under what we call something called the cosmological principle. And the cosmological principle is a set of assumptions. There are basically three that we believe are true, but for whatever reason, we can't verify that they're true. Either it's impossible or it just takes too long to do it. Now, these could be wrong, and we're more than happy to accept that they're wrong, but they don't appear to be wrong. The first one is called homogeneity. And it says on the largest scales, the local universe has the same physical properties throughout the universe. And so what that means is, we look at our galaxy, we have a spiral galaxy made up of atoms, a certain amount of dark matter in them. We have O stars through M stars. Basically all the laws that we've learned about, the nature of things, is the same throughout the universe. Now, there could be regions very far away that are completely different. They don't have dark matter at all. The star formation works very differently. They have different types of stars. We don't think that's true, but it's possible. And this assumption has to be made because it's impossible for us to know this. We cannot be in all places of the universe and verify that all the physical properties that we see around us are the same throughout. It's kind of like saying for plants, plants are here, in California have a root system, but somehow plants other places don't have a root system. They have a totally different means of extracting nutrients out of the ground. So that's what homogeneity is. Now, let me give you an example of how this might be violated. Maybe there's a distant galaxy somewhere that's not made up of normal matter. It's made up of antimatter. Antimatter being the same kind of particles with opposite charge on them. Protons are negatively charged and electrons are positively charged. And that's basically how the atoms are in this distant galaxy. That would violate homogeneity because you have a very different physical property for a galaxy. But like I said, we don't believe this is false, and we have no reason to believe it's false, but we can't technically verify this because it's physically impossible to do so. Another one is called isotropy. Isotropy says in the largest scales, the local universe looks the same in any direction. And what this boils down to is there is no preferred location in the universe. There isn't like a center to the expansion. There isn't a point in the universe that's special compared to everything else. And we could verify this. We'd have to take detailed pictures of the entire sky, which would take an absurd amount of time to do. It's basically like taking the Hubble Deep Field of the entire sky, and that would take thousands of years to do something like that. And so, you know, we don't see a preferred direction. We don't look in one particular, we don't take one picture of the sky and say there's something special about this location in the sky. All the galaxies are oriented differently there. Maybe all the galaxies are moving towards that spot or something like that. We don't believe that's true, that on a large scale, all locations are kind of, they are not unique, basically. And that's what Isotropy says. Then universality is the last of these, and it basically states that the laws of physics are the same everywhere in the universe. And, you know, if any of these are wrong, this one could be wrong. Basically, what we're saying is that the law of gravity, the way light works, the way atoms work, all the physical properties, all the laws that determine the physical properties of things, that they're the same in the entire universe throughout all of time. Something that would violate this is if the speed of light was different in the past. It was faster, slower, something like that. If the structure of the hydrogen atom was different in the past and somehow it's changed, that would violate universality. Again, these three things, we don't believe that they're wrong, but they could be wrong. And if they are, then everything we're talking about here would have to be thrown out the window and start from scratch, which is fine. But these are the assumptions we make, and it's called the cosmological principle. So what I'm going to, there's going to be a link at the in the description in the video. I can't put the link as a link in here because I can only link to YouTube videos. But look in the description of this video for a link to a BBC documentary. And the BBC documentary is very nice because it explains Hubble expansion. It explains the cosmic microwave background radiation, which are the two major pillars that support the Big Bang Theory. And they show a nice transition from steady state theory to Big Bang Theory. And it's basically, to give you an idea of what the documentary is, it's basically it's kind of a recap of previous documentaries that the BBC had shown in this series called Lost Horizons. And it's a really good documentary. It's kind of odd in the way the BBC can be. It's a little Willy Wonka-esque. But anyway, watch the video, and it explains all of the important cosmological observations that are made, and provides a lot of context for what's being done today. What's being done today is the Large Hadron Collider, which is in Geneva, Switzerland, on the border. And a lot of the work that's being done there is a combination of a lot of these observations and studies to determine the nature of the universe. They're trying to look for very small subatomic particles. So enjoy the video, and this is what I was going to show in lecture if I were to lecture. I'd basically introduce the video and talk about these principles here. So that's it.